Hello, everyone. Welcome back. I hope you had a great lunch. We have put the session back together again because we wanted everyone to be attending this panel. We're all watching closely what's been happening all over the Arab region, and we felt like it was very important. No internet conference could take place in the region without addressing the role that social media has played in the revolutions that have taken place. And so we've brought together a number of influential bloggers, activists, and media people. And some of them actually wanted to be here but couldn't make it. Amir al-Husseini, the editor of Global Voices, had to apologize yesterday because the situation in Bahrain has gotten significantly worse recently. And so I don't know if you saw her on the Twitter feed, but she was saying that she was really sad she couldn't make it and she was supposed to be here with us. Mohammed Nanabai could also not make it. He let me know yesterday because they're really involved with covering what's going on in Damascus. Sorry, in Syria right now, not in Damascus, in Daraa. So I'd like to now welcome my panelists on stage. We're going to have Mohammed with us on live stream. We're Skyping him in. I hope that given all the technological issues that we've had before, it'll work. Can we keep that to after? Okay, sure. So, well, quick pause before. Did you guys all notice the little red squares in your bags and all over the place with the little code that you had to crack? Yeah. How many people submitted an answer? Great. So, well, raise your hands again.
Maybe 3% answered right.
Yeah. How many? Maybe 3% actually. We had only 25 right answers. So the riddle was the Arabic text. For those who didn't know how to solve it, actually it was how many birthdays did Ahmed Shawqi have? But you write it using the Arabic keyboard. Now, this was actually a loaded riddle. It was a riddle in the riddle. For those who answered 62 or 63 or 64, I want to ask you, how many birthdays do you have? This is actually one. The others are anniversaries of birthdays.
Here, you want to do this?
So we want to select one winner in front of you. We're not cheating. I want to prove to you we're not cheating.
Tell them what the prize is.
Huh? Yeah, for those who read the riddle, the prize is actually an iPad 2 fresh from the States. We just got it with us just for this conference. Yeah. By the way, I didn't see the name. We want the winner to be from the audience. So whoever submitted the answer is not here, is their loss.
When?
How do you say this name?
Moyes?
Moyes.
He's an official blogger.
Really?
Yes. Omar, you should say something about it.
Moyes is one of our official bloggers, so Mabruk.
Thank you,
N2V, for the gift. Okay, so back to our original programming. I'd like to now take the opportunity to introduce the moderator for the panel, Mr. Samih Tuqan, who actually doesn't need any introduction. For anyone working in the internet industry, Samih is a role model, and he is the founder of Maktoub, which was sold to Yahoo last year, and is the biggest M&A that's happened in the web space in the region. Now he's the chairman of Jabbar Internet Group. And Samih was very actively following and tweeting about everything that was happening very passionately. And so when I talked to him about getting involved in the conference, I thought that moderating this panel would be an ideal thing for him. So, Samih.
Good afternoon. Are we ready for some revolution talk?
Yeah.
Okay, good. That's the excitement we want. Well, last year I was on a panel in ArabNet talking about the Yahoo Maktoub deal, which was, in my opinion, a revolution in the internet industry in the region. Today, after 1 year, I find myself, without planning, talking about real revolutions on the ground in the Arab world. It is amazing what can happen in 1 year, not even in 1 year, in the last two or three months. What we're seeing is just unbelievable and incredible. People ask me, why am I speaking out and not focusing on business and entrepreneurship? My answer is that I learned as an entrepreneur to break the rules, to not accept the status quo. For me, it is all related. A democratic and free society will only encourage creativity, entrepreneurship, and innovation. How many of you have heard of a very famous person called Basbousa? Okay, there are a few people here. Well, on December 17th, 2010, a 27-year-old man known by his friends as Basbousa left a message on Facebook for his mother. The message said, "I will be traveling my mom. Forgive me. I am lost in my way. It is not in my hands. Forgive me if I disobeyed your words, my mom. Blame our times and do not blame me." This was Muhammad Bouazizi. This was Muhammad Bouazizi from Sidi Bouzid in Tunisia, who burnt himself that day in protest of unemployment and repeated humiliation by government officials. Little did Muhammad know that he changed the Arab world once and for all. He triggered a domino of revolutions that are happening as we speak in countries around us. And little did Mark Zuckerberg, the founder of Facebook, know that his website, which was supposed to be a yearbook friendship application, turned out to play an important role in uprisings and revolutions that continue to sweep the region. This panel will explore how social media has been used and influenced these revolutions. The famous American writer, Malcolm Gladwell, how many people have read his book, The Tipping Point? Okay, this is a recommended book for those who want to start a business and for those who want to start a revolution as well. So he has other famous books as well, Blink, Outlies, and so on. He disagreed. He said, before the revolutions happened in the Arab world, that social media such as Facebook and Twitter create so-called weak links rather than deep personal connections that are more useful for job searches than revolutions. He believes successful revolutions and movements have their roots in years of deliberate planning and strategy among small groups of people united by strong ties. So he believes that Facebook and Twitter creates weak ties. And to create a revolution, you know, you need strong ties of trust and deep knowledge of one another. Was Gladwell wrong or was he right? Well, when the revolution in Egypt happened, only 5 to 7% of the people of Egypt were on Facebook. So how could have Facebook possibly affected? What was the role of social media played in these revolutions? I would like to start introducing the panel, starting with Mr. Fuad Al-Farhan, founder and CEO of Nailam from Saudi Arabia. Besides being the founder of two technology startups, Fuad Al-Farhan is a popular Saudi blogger and political commentator, noted for his advocacy of political reforms. For years, he has been advocating the use of social media to strengthen free speech and self-expression in Saudi Arabia. Fuad was previously imprisoned for several months And he could not travel. This is, by the way, his first travel out of Saudi Arabia for the last 4 years. Welcome, Fahd. Our next panelist is Mr. Mohammed Al-Dahshan from Egypt. Mohammed Dahshan is a consultant on development policy, interested in private sector development, investment climate promotion, and post-conflict reconstruction. He is a blogger and a freelance writer whose articles have been published in a number of outlets, including Al Masri Al Yawm, The New York Times, and Foreign Policy Magazine. As you all know, Amira Husseini could not make it from Bahrain, so we all wish her and all the people of Bahrain the best of luck with these difficult times. Mr. Mohammed Nananbai will be with us on Skype. He's the head of Al Jazeera Online, English, Al Jazeera English Online. He's also an internet entrepreneur and active angel investor. And last but not least, I'd like to welcome from Lebanon, Ms. Nadine Muawad, who is a social entrepreneur, online campaigner. She works on gender equality and social change in the Arab world and is heavily involved with the anti-sectarian demonstrations in Lebanon and the United Lebanon movement. So I'd like to start each panelist, if they can give us their thoughts about the role of social media and revolutions and their personal experience that they have had in these days. Shall we start with Mr. Mohammed Dahshan?
It's a delight being here. Thank you for having us. I'll start with two main points. The first one being, was it a Facebook revolution? It's the question that we get every time I meet someone. They ask, did you guys think that Egypt was a Facebook revolution? Was it a Twitter revolution? Was it something else? I generally start by saying no, it's not a Facebook revolution, partly because I'm pretty sure that half the people I demonstrated with, the people who were there since the very first day in Tahrir Square, the people whom you know we shared food and security with, I'm pretty sure that half of them have never used a computer. So I think it's a little disrespectful to them to say that it's a Facebook thing. The second thing is, Facebook is a tool. It's a communication mechanism. I don't think that, I mean, for some reason we've come to want to give names of colors and of flowers to revolutions, but the reality is I don't think we can speak of, the telephone war for World War II, for instance. It's a tool. It's not. It's just a conduit. It's not what happens. It's not the content, and it's not the people. This said, I mean, there's no denying that Facebook and other social media tools had a role. I mean, so much that there is a little girl that was born a few days after the revolution, and her father named her Facebook. I do not want to be there on her first day at school. But there's a reason for that. There's a reason why there was people in Tahrir Square saying Facebook ala kulla zalim with a little banner that had jokes. There another one said, you know, thank you to the administrator of the Khaled Said group, which was a Facebook group that was very, very helpful when it came to mobilizing people. So social media did have a role, and I guess I'll put that very, very succinctly, I hope, into mobilization, got people engaged for the several months before the revolution, got people in keen on being part of the social movement that was starting, that was building up in Egypt. So mobilization, organization, it was extremely important to give information very rapidly, to get information out about where people were meeting, where the gatherings were happening, where the demonstration was happening, and what better way of doing that than sending a message to 20,000 people instantly, rather than the more public ways, which generally the government and security forces could preempt. And the last one was information. It's no secret that the information coming out of Egypt during the revolution was not always complete, was not always honest, and didn't always come through. there was a time when there were days, well, the state television was, that was a disaster, put that aside. There was things were going on fire in Tahrir Square, and the Egyptian state television had, you know, butterflies and flowers. So they were not very, very trustworthy. Other sources that are more credible found their work blocked. Al Jazeera offices, Al Jazeera people were arrested several times. Their offices were raided, the material confiscated, etc. It became incumbent to people on the square who were taking photos, tweeting, sending them out. They had this duty of information. And that leads me to this, to, I guess, the second point and I would like to start with is what I call the tweet to news cycle, is how social media, and Twitter in particular, and traditional media interfaced, how they normally do in regular conditions and how they did under the pressure that was the revolution. The presence of before, outside of pressure times, let's say, mainstream media would use Twitter as a feedback mechanism, asking people what they thought about this program or that, asking them about their opinion about a certain bit of news, starting some sort of an online poll, who they thought they wanted to vote for, etc. But under pressure, you had very different mechanism of communication. Part of it, which was very interesting, is that at one point, because things were happening so quickly and because some journalists were actually on the ground, we had the official Twitter feeds of several news outlets, of several journalists, where the news were out first. So, I mean, I can think of Ben Widerman of CNN and Ayman Mohideen of Al Jazeera, essentially would be out on the square with us, and they would report the news on Twitter before they reported it to their newsroom. So the breaking news coming out of mainstream media became on Twitter first, on television second. Further down the line, mainstream media sources realized that there were tweeters that were on the ground and they were credible enough and started recommending them to their followers. So Foreign Policy had a little bit of an article that was titled Who to Follow in Egypt and had a list of tweeters. But the next phase, and this is where, in my opinion, it becomes quite interesting, is when mainstream media starts using tweets as a source. Now, you can do that when they reference a source, they say that, you know, someone on the ground says that, or we hear that there's that. The problem is that when they try to reference someone who is, generally speaking, a credible citizen journalist, but the information that comes becomes wrong. For instance, there was an instance which I noticed, I'm sure many others did, was of a very credible citizen journalist was on the square with us, and would write for something along the lines of, "Wow, this is an amazing gathering. I believe there are 2 million people on the square today." The problem becomes when mainstream media takes that number and says sources on the ground say there are two million people on the square. Now, where did we blur the line between you know, referencing someone who is a citizen journalist and start treating them as the journalist on the ground? So these are a few thoughts, and I hope that we can take those further into discussion. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Muhammad. Fuad, can you give us your ideas about the role of social media in Saudi Arabia and how it played and how it compares to other Arab countries?
Yes. First of all, I would like to say something, which is what we are seeing is this Arab uprising, which is amazing. We've dreamed about it, we've read about it, we've heard stories about it, and we have heroes, we have winners, and we have martyrs. And we have the sense of, Arab nationalism, but the sense of proudness in the Arab world. And I would really love, after the permission of Mr. Samih and others, I would like to speak in Arabic.
I think we have the instant translation, right, for those who don't speak Arabic?
Yes.
Okay, good. Please go ahead.
I really apologize for that, but I think you really can understand that. في يوم 26 أبريل 2008 هذا اليوم اللي كان خرجت فيه من أسميها البعثة أو السجن كنت في بيت منزل والدتي. الاتصالات تأتي اتصال وراء ثاني وتهاني وسؤال. أجاني اتصال من صديق مصري، صديق هذا معرفتي فيه طويلة جدا يمكن 15-16 سنة. فبعد المباركة وكيف الوضع وكيف نفسيتك وكيف حالك، قال لي أنت سمعت بحاجة إيش صار في 6 أبريل؟ قلت له والله ما سمعت حاجة. قال لي ما كان عندك تلفزيون شيء؟ قلت ما كان عندي حاجة. قال لي صار في مصر حاجة كبيرة يوم 6 أبريل، حركة 6 أبريل، الاعتصام، إسراء عبد الفتاح، حاجة كبيرة. فجلس يحدثني عن تأثير الفيسبوك وكيف صار اعتصام تاريخي أو إضراب تاريخي في مصر، تم تهيئته والتجهيز له بأسلوب بسيط جدا. وقال كلمة واحدة، قال مصر حتتغير خلال 2 إلى 3 سنوات. هذا 2008، 2011 لسه ما وصلنا يمكن 26 أبريل، تغيرت مصر. هذا الشخص اسمه وائل غنيم. الحقيقة كما قال وائل نفسه، كما قال محمد، مثل هذه الثورات الأبطال هم 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 الشعب نفسه، هي الروح. وأنا ما أنا يعني big fan of إعطاء قوة كبيرة ودافع كبير للسوشيال ميديا على الإنسان نفسه، على المواطن نفسه، لأن حقيقة هذا اللي شفناه هو نتيج تراكم عشرات السنين، تراكم تضحيات، تراكم سجون، تراكم شهداء. وفي نفس الوقت الجميع لعب فيه، الفاسد لعب دور بدعم الفساد، اللص لعب دور بالسرقة، الظالم لعب دور بالظلم، وفي الجانب الآخر صاحب الفكرة لعب دور بتأسيس الفكرة، المربي لعب دور. فأنا ضد تعظيم دور هذه بحيث أنها تكون في ثورة فيسبوك أو تويتر. يعني في مثال بسيط، يعني هل تتخيلوا إذا حد يعرف كم كان عدد مستخدمي تويتر في تونس قبل ثورة البو عزيزي؟ بحسب الغارديان، إذا في أحد يبغى يخمن رقم عدد اليوزرز 2000 والأكتف 200 بتونس قبل الثورة. فتفضل. That's a Guardian numbers, which is a British newspaper. في النهاية يعني ما تقدر تنسب هذا الشيء لهذه الوسائل. تحتاج الفكرة الأساسية، الناس ليش يثوروا في النهاية؟ الفكرة هذه اللي صنعت تعب فيها ناس كثير، من مفكر، من مربي، من معلم، وتعب في نشرها ناس كثير، في تبنيها، في مؤسسات، في حراك. فبالتالي المؤسسات نفسها، تويتر وفيسبوك والسوشيال ميديا نتوركس والتولز هذه كلها نوعا ما هي بنفسها تحاول تنأى عن أنها لعبت دور كبير حتى لا تأثر في البزنس والمستقبل حقها، لكن البروباغندا اللي حولها تحاول تلعب دور كبير في هذا الشيء. اللي أبغى أقوله في هذا الشأن أنه هي يعني ننسى حاجة رئيسية، الجوال نفسه، الموبايل نفسه اللي يسجل بالفيديو هذا وينشر، هذا قبل السوشيال نتورك، هذا الأداة الأساسية، هذا سلاح المواطن لما يحصل حالة قتل أو حالة تعذيب أو حالة شيء. هذا اللي نذكر يعني وائل عباس في مصر قبل سنين كان يشتغل على هذا الجانب والتسجيل هذا الجانب والتسريبات. فكلها في النهاية تبقى أدوات، لكن في الأساس يبقى الإنسان صاحب الطموح، صاحب الفكرة وصاحب الروح. الأدوات رايح تتطور وليس لها، والتقنيات رايح تتقدم وليس لها حدود، لكن الإنسان بنفسه بروحه بفكره هذا اللي يستحق الاهتمام الحقيقي، التوجيه الحقيقي. الجيل الجديد، الأطفال، هنا التحدي الكبير.
شكرا.
تبغى تتكلم عن السعودية؟ أعتقد ممكن سؤال.
عفوا.
بالنسبة للسعودية أعتقد ممكن في إطار الثورات الأخرى نتكلم إذا تحب. أو
تفضل.
لا يعني
خلي أنا عندي سؤال لك قبل ما أعطي الحكي لنادين. سؤالي أنك أنت بلشت الأكتيفيزم تبعك خلينا نقول قبل الثورات العربية، يعني في مدة، يعني سؤال دائما إحنا الشباب دائما في حاجز الخوف عنا. في شباب كتير بحبوا يحكوا ولكن دائما تعرف الأنظمة العربية بخافوا من المخابرات ومن كيف أنت تخطيت حاجز الخوف وما الذي دفعك يعني تكون صوت قليل؟ يعني ما كانش في غيرك او يمكن اقلاء اللي كانوا يحكوا قبل الثورات في الوقت الحاضر.
يعني انا اعتقد انه الاصوات الحقيقيه ولا الابطال الحقيقيون في العاده الناس ما تعرف اساميهم، وهذه قناعه حقيقيه والاساس عندي. بالنسبه لي شغلي في النت، يعني يمكن علاقتي بالنت من عام 96 بدري شوي، والاهتمام في هذا الجانب، اللي تعرف كل انسان عنده area of expertise و area of interest. فغالبا بتلاحظ انت في عالم التقنيه، المهتمين بعالم التقنيه والearly adapters واليوزرز حقيقي يلاحظوا من خلال التقنيه، يحاولوا يستكشفوا المجتمعات الاخرى، يستكشفوا ايش قاعد يصير، يستكشفوا الحقوق المفقوده في مجتمعاتهم، كيف ممكن الحصول عليها بشكل سلمي وبشكل حضاري. فهي يعني تجارب. في النهاية كل إنسان عنده طموح، طموح شخصي وطموح على مستوى المجتمع وعلى مستوى العائلة، وهذا يتنامى. الخوف يعني الخوف مشروع في حالات وغير مشروع في حالات، واللي يحكم على الخوف منطقي أو غير منطقي حقيقة هي ثقافة الإنسان وثقافة الدائرة اللي هو حوله. فإذا كان هو في دائرة صغيرة جدا رسخت فيه من الطفولة عوامل خوف مؤثرة، يحتاج وقت لما يخرج. إذا كان في دائرة وفي مجتمع وفي في منطقة تساعد في هذا الشيء، تساعد استكشاف، تساعد على تبني حرية الرأي، حرية التعبير، يبدأ يكتشف الآفاق هذه لاحقاً. لكن ما في شك أن وسائل الاتصال الاجتماعية وغيرها من خلال الإنترنت سرعت هذا الشيء. يعني الشاب الآن يفتح شيء، يتابع أخبار في بلد ثاني، في أجزاء من الثانية، هو لا إرادياً يسأل نفسه، يقول ليش هذا الشيء الكويس عندهم مثلاً ما هو عندنا؟ ليش هذا الحدث يصير هناك وهو شكل جاي الحق يمارسون احنا ما هو عندنا؟ هذه الاشياء تتخزن لا اراديا في العقل الباطن عند الشاب هذا، وتتراكم لما يشوف مظاهر سلبيه. في نفس الوقت يبدا يقارن، يقول ليش هذا الشيء موجود هنا وليش ما موجود هناك؟ هذا ما يحتاج فيها معلم. هذه المقارنه ما بين وضع مجتمع شاب في بلده وبين مجتمعات ثانيه تؤثر فيه على مدى سنين لاحقا. يبدا يشوف هذه الاشياء انها بشكل انها والله هي تصير هناك وهنا، بس في النهايه حق انساني مثل حرية التعبير، حرية التجمع، الممارسات السياسية، هذه الأشياء هي كل حريات. فهي شيء تراكمي. وأعتقد بالنسبة لي أنا الآن مقابل يعني مجموعة جديدة موجودة بالسعودية وبالخليج وبجيل جديد، المساح المناخ بدأ يسمح بهذا الشكل بشكل كبير جدا، سواء في التعبير في الاستكشاف. وبالتالي أنا بالنسبة لي أعتبر لا شيء مقارنة بالشيء الموجودين الآن.
شكرا فؤاد. نادين، نادين بدي اعتذر منك، since you're a feminist and a woman rights advocate, I'm not gonna apply the ladies first rule and move directly to Muhammad Nananbai, who's with us I think on Skype. Muhammad, can you hear us?
Yeah, just barely.
Great. Can you give us your thoughts, please, about the role social media has played in the revolutions in the Arab world and the role Al Jazeera has played as well?
Okay. So, you know, I think this is a fascinating fact for everybody working in the media to see a transformation. I think transformation and shift that everyone in this audience shouldn't be surprised by. I think, you know, as all of sitting here at ArabNet would know the power of online media and social media. But what was interesting about it was just the interaction between mass media and social media. So the first thing I think, you know, that should be very clear to everybody is that, you know, many people have tried to label the revolutions that have started in Tunisia, Egypt, and spreading through the region as Twitter revolutions, Facebook revolutions, WikiLeaks revolutions, or Al Jazeera revolutions. But one thing which I think is absolutely certain and that no one should have any doubt about was, you know, this was a Tunisian revolution, an Egyptian revolution, Twitter, Facebook, and so on would be doing an injustice to all the people who sacrificed in these countries and sacrificed up years and years of subjugation. You know, I think, you know, there were real issues in these societies. and across the region. And after 30 years and 40 years, people finally came out and transformed societies that they were living in. And to try to ascribe this to a technology would be doing a great injustice to all of those throughout the region. Now, the role that social media played, I heard one of the speakers mentioning this earlier, talking about some of the statistics looking at how many people have access to Twitter and Facebook within the region. And what was very important about it was, you know, yes, these weren't mass tools. These were tools that were used by people unlike those sitting in the room today. They were used to organize prior to the revolutions. They were used extensively to network, for people to connect to each other, to gather themselves. Yet once things started, once things kicked off in Tunisia and in Egypt, what was this cycle and ecosystem that emerged between what's happening online by a core group of activists and how this was transmitted to broader society? So, you know, if I can put it very simplistically, and of course, you know, this is something that will be a subject that many people will study over the next few years in many PhD dissertations, I'm sure will be written on this. But just to really put it very simplistically, we had, you know, a core group of people who were organizing using these tools. They came out onto the streets. They were the initial wave of protesters. These images were then broadcast back into the countries, into Egypt, Tunisia, and through the rest of the Arab world. As people created media using their mobile phones, using their flip cams, using, you know, the technologies that they had in their pockets, these were then picked up by the mass media, by Al Jazeera, by others, and rebroadcast back to the rest of society. So, you know, if you think that only 5% or 7% had access to Facebook or Twitter, as soon as those images that started off on YouTube and on Facebook and Twitter were picked up by the mass media and broadcast, you know, 70% of the population through Al Jazeera. And this was significant. And this ecosystem that then developed between people on the ground and, you know, Al Jazeera and other broadcasters was the real change that we saw in the media. Because suddenly you didn't see the tension that existed and that people had spoken about for the last 10 years about our bloggers, journalists. You know, this tension disappeared, and suddenly we had an ecosystem where everybody worked together, where the mass media would take and amplify the voices of those on the street, and vice versa. Many times you'd see that, you know, Al Jazeera would be broadcasting something, and people, you know, online would then be further amplifying that. So you created this feedback loop where people would talk, amplify, broadcast, remix, create, and send further. And this is something that we were well prepared for as Al Jazeera, right? Something that we had seen coming, you know, for the last 5-6 years. We've been holding conference in Doha, and, you know, we've always, many of the bloggers and people who are involved over the last 3 months were guests of ours and hosted in our forum. So, you know, we've been building these ties, we've been training our journalists in how to use social media. And if you look at Egypt, and if you look at the time when the internet was cut off in the country, nothing stopped. In fact, more people came out onto the streets. More people came out into Tahrir. It showed that it wasn't just something that was being led by social media. It was something that the society had moved so far along, moved past this tipping point, and everybody, it was such a critical mass that regardless of whether it was available or not, things would continue. But during this time, you know, when, you know, our signal in Egypt was being blocked, our television signal, it was cut off, and people, there was an attempt by the regime to deny access to information, to deny access to information coming out as well. And what you saw emerge very quickly was that people wouldn't accept suddenly this information vacuum. They stood back and said, this is how it is, and accept not having images. Suddenly you saw hundreds and thousands of cameras picking up. So when our cameras were escaping in Cairo, and our journalists arrested, suddenly some people in Cairo coming out, recording, and sending that back to us in one way or another. So it wasn't as if Al Jazeera had one or two or three cameras, but suddenly you had thousands of cameras spread through the country, recording, and then these were broadcast back to everybody. everybody in the world, and you know, in fact, across the globe. And I think it was this interaction, this ecosystem that developed between what was going on in the social, what we call social media, and what was going on in the mass media, was the real change and the real shift that we had seen. And I think what it did was it empowered people. If you had your camera and you were out in the street and you were afraid of the regime, you know, it would be easy for a regime 10 years ago or 15 years ago to crush a protest. Nobody there, you have state-controlled media, it would be very easy to control the message. But now that you've got many cameras, you've got Jazeera, you've got others, and you've got a host of people with mobile phones recording things constantly, it's much more difficult to be able to do this. And the dynamic, if people come out on the street and it's recorded, and that's broadcast, more people come out on the street, more people record, more people broadcast. And this continues and continues, and you suddenly see this snowball effect. So what we had was not only the young people coming out into the street, the core of activists doing this, but once it was rebroadcast by Al Jazeera and by others back to the living room, we saw their parents come out onto the street.
Muhammad,
and at this point, you know...
I'm sorry, I have to cut you because the line is not great and I need to move on. We'll try to take some questions later and try, maybe it's better, but I don't think the quality of the line is good enough. So I apologize from you.
Thank you.
Nadine, can you give us your thoughts about what's happening in Lebanon and what's the role of social media in that?
Yes. First, I want to say I always thought the idea of ladies first was a bit silly, so I don't mind.
I thought so.
And I also want to say, I want to start off by saying that I'm very humbled to be on this plenary talking about, you know, great work that's been done, and I want to give a shout out to Amira who couldn't be here today. And I think it's great also. I think it's great also that we remember also that a lot of the activists on these social medias and on the ground have been women in these revolutions. They've been more than half of the people protesting and putting their bodies out there and themselves out there for freedom and for independence. So also a big, big salute to all the women who are protesting as well. Okay, I want to start off by saying that slow internet connections are a form of censorship. They're not funny. You can see on the Twitter feed that some tweeps have put together something called Onternet to protest how slow the internet in Lebanon is. And it's a little bit funny, but actually research has shown that around the world in places in Asia and in Africa, slow, bad infrastructure is a form of censorship. You don't need to censor YouTube, you just need to make it really slow so that people who want to upload videos from the ground, they don't have the time to upload. If mobile internet is expensive and if connections are expensive and if the infrastructure isn't there, then you're not going to have even the option of, you know, Twitter revolutions or Facebook revolutions or any of that thought. So it's very important that we remember that the internet is tied to politics, and this was made very clear in Egypt and in Tunisia when attempts to block the internet, to censor the internet were made in order to silence the people. But of course, it was shown that the best way to get the people to the ground was actually to cut off their internet. And I want to talk about two things to add to what Fuad and Muhammad had said. I think we are beyond the debate about whether this was a Twitter or Facebook revolution. I think that debate was mostly came out of newspapers from the West, from Western Europe, from Northern America, who were fascinated with, you know, Arabs using technology to speak up and to blog and to do these things. And on the ground, it was never really an issue. I think people embraced that social media is word of mouth. That's really everything it is. It's just a technologically advanced form of word of mouth, speaking to each other. And I want to talk about a couple of the things that I think enabled social media to support the revolutions, because we all agree that it supported. It enabled everybody in the Arab world, all the allies, to work together to support the news, to put the news out there, to retweet. And we saw how before Arab Twitter accounts used to have, you know, 3,000, 4,000 followers and be considered huge accounts, and now you've got 20,000, 30,000, It has something like 120,000 people following him now. And it's without a doubt that social media has supported these revolutions. But let's think a little bit about how and what are the things that enabled, and maybe then the online community and everybody here at ArabNet, you know, the companies, the startups, the entrepreneurs, everybody can help with. We need to develop more applications to support the protesters, to support, you know, bypassing censorship. We need to, from the private sector, create networks that can help even push this information further and help the activists connect even more. And this is something very tangible that we can do in addition to, you know, creating apps and gaming software and profit businesses and all of that. We need to also be supporting the activists on the ground. And the second thing I want to note is that for people who've been active on Twitter over the last 3 years, like Fuad was saying before, the ideas have been cooking for a really long time. Yani the Khalid Saeed hashtag was on, the protests in Alexandria were on for a while before they were able to culminate in a big revolution. And a lot of the people back then would, you know, tweet for a few days about, you know, Sidi Bouzid, and then it wouldn't be cool anymore, or it would drop off the radar. And that's why it's very important now today for us to keep on supporting, you know, Libya and Yemen and Bahrain and reform Jordan and in Syria and Daraa, everything that's happening. We need to keep the level up because we know that mainstream media will look to the next, you know, attractive thing that's happening and will sway away from the things that we think are really important. I also want to talk a bit about the situation in Lebanon, which is, you know, very different from other places, because in other places such as Egypt, for example, the big, huge manifestation of the revolution was people going to the ground. And in Lebanon, people go to the ground all the time. Like they, you know, it's a trend, it's fun, they want to copy, we have these, I personally think it's shameful for Lebanon to claim that we invented the revolutions in the region. I think that's very bad when politicians go out and say that we started the revolutions. But it's part of the democracy, the political environment that Lebanon enables. So to go to the ground has not been enough for us. We've been organizing these protests over Sundays. They've been very peaceful protests. They've increased from 1,000 to like 15,000. The last protest on Sunday was between 30 and 35,000 people who went onto the streets to demand a fall of the sectarian regime. It's very clear that nobody has a complete understanding of what that entails. And it's very clear that while social media can support us in getting the word out and in mobilizing each other, because it is, again, word of mouth, it's very difficult to have constructive arguments on social media. It's very difficult to discuss topics. It's very difficult to convince people. And we can see what's happening to our Facebook groups that are calling for the fall of the sectarian regime. People are getting super aggressive with each other. The comments are, it's almost as if nobody's listening to one another. So I don't know how much social media enables conversation. Although I've heard it said a lot that people discuss things on social media. I think the power of social media is in demonstrating what's happening right now. So when we see a video of the demonstration in Daraa, we see people being killed on video in Bahrain, that's powerful. But to open a conversation that's political and think, what are we going to do now? I think, you know, that remains for halls and for workshops and for meetings in person, and it's actually quite difficult to do it on the social networks.
Thank you, Nadine. Muhammad, how did the relationship between social and mainstream media evolve, and where do you see it going in the future, particularly when citizen journalists become the primary source of information?
Well, it's evolved very rapidly, and the way it evolves under pressure is very different from the way it evolves in normal times. But what we saw happen, خلال الثورة, essentially, was that there were times when the only source of news was citizen journalists. When traditional media was unable to get to where things were happening, or they, well, because of physical limitations, because things were happening too quickly, because they were, as happened in Egypt and other places, They were being actively censored. They were not allowed to file their reports. It becomes incumbent to citizen journalists to provide the news task, to inform, report as honestly as they can. Now a lot of citizen journalists have taken upon themselves really to have the same level, or I like to think of it as the same level of ethics as traditional media, of checking their sources, of reporting their sources, of differentiating between rumors and actual information and not passing that on. So that was quite important. Mainstream media, on the other hand, has a duty, and that's something that they've come to realize. They have been realizing lately. They've come to realize it more throughout the Arab revolutions. But the duty that mainstream media has is to get to know their counterpart, to get to know their citizen counterparts. The people on the ground do a great job. Very often there's a disconnect between them and between mainstream media. The followership of people online can be usually is very different from the followership of mainstream media. So it becomes incumbent to news networks, television channels, to newspaper, etc., to know who are the people who are their counterparts, who are their colleagues, who are serving the same purpose that they are, and to learn how to work with them hand in hand, not just use them as often has been the case, as some sort of an appendix to their news report, or to have a little 3-minute segment. You know, this is what the Twitter sphere is saying about a certain topic. So there still is a duty of learning. There's some learning that needs to be done on both sides, but I think the mainstream media is trying to catch up.
Thank you. Nadine, can you give us some thoughts about how that differs in Lebanon? Because in Lebanon, the mainstream media is relatively freer, I think, than probably other Arab countries.
I wouldn't call it freer. I think there is a form of freedom of press, but mainstream media is extremely politicized, and you cannot get neutral coverage from anybody at all on what's happening on the ground, and that's why it's even more important for us in Lebanon to bypass these myths about our freedom of press and our freedom of TV and our freedom of coverage, and turn to citizens on the ground who are not always independent, but we can certainly foster, and there's been lots of initiatives to foster the blogosphere to be covering events and commentating politically and providing some analysis on what's going on. So I think it's just as equally important in Lebanon as well.
Okay, last question to Fuad before I open to the audience. Akh Fuad, ما هو الفرق بين ما يحدث في السعودية وبقية الدول العربية؟ ولماذا لم ينجح يوم الغضب السعودي في 11 آذار؟
Interesting. Can I answer this in English?
Yes. طبعا لما صارت تونس كلنا نعرف انه وزير خارجية مصر قال مصر غير، ولما صارت مصر قال علي عبد الله صالح اليمن غير، وفي ناس كثير قالوا السعودية غير، وحقيقة أن السعودية غير، وهذا اللي حصل. أنا أعتقد أنه في فرق بين حالتين، في حالة الشعوب الجاهزة، الجاهزية للتغيير والإصلاح، والجاهزية للثورة، وأنا أعتقد أن هذه حالتين مختلفة. مصر مثلا جاهزة من سنوات للتغيير والإصلاح، إذا نذكر من حركة كفاية، من قبل ذلك، من سنين، وأنا ما أنا خبير في الشأن المصري مثلك، لكن متابع بالحراك في الساحة، الاعتصامات، الإضرابات، عمال المصانع، من 7-8 سنوات وهذا الحراك موجود، فالشعب كان ينتظر، والشعب كان يطالب، يا ابن الحلال غير، يا ابن الحلال اصلح، من سنوات، الجهاز السياسي رفض هذا الشيء، وتجاوز هذا الشيء، لما وصل الشعب إلى حالة الجاهزية للثورة. يوم حصلت الثورة قال طيب ايش تبغوا حكومة؟ هذه حكومة جديدة، هذه إصلاحات جديدة، خلاص راح الوقت. اللي حاصل انه عندنا وفي أماكن أخرى الحقيقة أن الشعوب جاهزة للإصلاح، جاهزة للتغيير، جاهزة للانفتاح، ولكن في نفس الوقت ما هي مستعدة للدخول في مغامرة غير معروف نتائجها في تغيير شامل مثل ما حصل في دول أخرى. السؤال هل هذا محتوم؟ هل هذا دائم؟ أنا أعتقد أنه إحنا ومثل غيرنا كلنا بشر في النهاية، فهي مسألة ظروف وأوقات ما بين شعب لآخر. لكن الشيء الإيجابي اللي يلعبه السوشيال ميديا بالسعودية يفرق كثير عن دول أخرى. في فرق، يعني السوشيال ميديا مثلا أو الأدوات هذه في مجتمعات أخرى، مجتمعات أصلا يوجد فيها مثلا مؤسسات المجتمع المدني، يوجد فيها حراك سياسي، يوجد فيها أحزاب، يوجد فيها مؤسسات، يوجد فيها حرية التجمع، يوجد فيها حرية الإضراب والاعتصام. هذه الأشياء ما عندنا إحنا. فاللي قاعد يصير إنه من خلال المجتمع، من خلال الإعلام الاجتماعي، الشباب جالس يستكشف هذه الحقوق وجالس يبحث فيها، هل هي حقوق أم لا، هل هي من حقنا أم لا، طيب كيف نحصل عليها. هذا الحوار موجود وملحوظ، وهذا ما تجده في الإعلام التقليدي، تجده فقط في الإعلام الجديد. فالأرضية الإعلام الجديد دوره هو في ترسيخ وبناء مؤسسات المجتمع المدني أولا، التبشير فيها قبل الترسيخ ومحاولة الحصول عليها، وليس أكثر من ذلك. لكن خارج دول عربية وأخرى لا، فيها الفاونديشنز هذه، يعني فيها المؤسسات، فيها الحرية، فيها الدستور اللي يكفل هذه الأشياء. فإحنا تقدر تقول إحنا زينا زي غيرنا، لكن إحنا في بدايات هذا الشيء، وكلنا أمل إنه هذا ينتج في النهاية إلى موافقة بشكل أو بآخر، طموحات ما بين الجيل الجديد اللي يشكل 70% أو 75% أقل من 30 سنة، وما بين الحراك والقيادة في البلد يعني.
شكرا. Let's open the questions to the audience. Please, we want some brave and controversial questions.
Thank you for waiting. My name is Salam Yamut. والسؤال لزميلتي اللبنانية نادين معود وللشباب اللي كانوا عم يعملوا تويت، ليه ما بتدعوا لمظاهرة؟ الشعب يريد تحرير قطاع الاتصالات.
هو في عدة مبادرات من هالنوع. في ناس طلعوا بفكرة إنه بننزل على البرلمان وبنفتح يوتيوب فيديو بنقول لهم مش فايلين إلا ليعمل لود. أنا بعتقد هاي كانت فكرة فانكي أوزي، ما بتذكر مين أول شخص طلع فيها. بس في شغلة مهمة كتير، وفي يعني في مبادرات من هالنوع. والمبادرات لحديت هلأ بتضحك، لأنه يخدينا شوية بضحك، بس لازم تكون في مبادرات جدية. إذا نخدها كنوع من السنسورشيب، من يعني عم تقلل من الإمكانيات تبعنا، وإذا البرايفت سيكتر بفوتوا معنا وبيدفشوا أكتر، منخلي هالسياسيين يرجعوا إنه يشدوا حالهم شوي، يصير في بدل ما يتخانقوا على وزارة الاتصالات يصير في تحسين بقلب الوزارة. فأنا أظن إنه مبادرة كتير مهمة. بركي أنت سلام بتحركي لنا إياها كمان شوي. أنا معك، ننزل.
What happened in Tunisia happened in a way that wasn't how to say it in English. Expected, wasn't expected. No one until the day our president, ex-president, the bastard left. No one did believe it. No one did believe it. Let me be honest with you. Twitter and Facebook was more than a tool for us. It was a way to lose our fear. When first on Thursday night he came out and he had his speech, everyone was happy. Okay, it's fine. We get the reform. That's what we needed. But Twitter and Facebook were the ones who encouraged everyone to ask for more and go out on Fridays. I believe that this was like the key success for that revolution. The fact that social media played a role that take it out the fear of people. And we did went away. Ammar 404 was the first step. The revolution was the second. My question is, do you believe the other like countries in the region, including Saudi Arabia, will be fine with a reform?
Will be fine? Yeah. Sorry, can you repeat it?
Will be fine. Like that's what they need.
Yeah, will be sufficient.
Yeah, exactly.
You mean with reform rather than revolution?
Exactly. Yeah.
Okay.
Well, what happened last Friday, if I remember correctly, there was some interesting economic king orders, and I think that made so many people happy. أنا رحت إنجليزي ونسيت العربي.
الإصلاحات الاقتصادية أعتقد أنها حققت رغبات شريحة كبيرة من المجتمع. الإصلاحات السياسية لا زال كثير يسعى فيها. لكن أجين عودة للسؤال، ليش فشل يوم 11 مارس بالسعودية؟ أعتقد في عدة أسباب. بالنسبة لنا إحنا كسعوديين مهتمين بالشأن العام كانت واضحة من قبل. أول حاجة اللي يفرق عنا عن غيرنا، الاعتصامات المظاهرات هذا شيء ما هو مكفول دستوريا ولا هو مسموح فيه قانونيا أصلا من الأصل، موجودة في مجتمعات أخرى مكفولة قانونيا ويسمح بها في حدود خاصة. ثاني حاجة، لا يوجد في الثقافة السعودية، ثقافة المجتمع، هذا الشيء ممسوح ما عدا جزء صغير في المجتمع أو قليل أقلية هذا موجود فيها. فعدم وجود الغطاء القانوني وعدم وجود الثقافة. الشيء الثالث أنه الناس اللي دعوا لهذا اليوم هم ناس مجهولين تماما، يعني الناس المهتمين بالإصلاح بالسعودية سواء في التيارات الفكرية والتيارات السياسية أو سواء من الناشطين على الإنترنت لم يدعوا أي شخص معروف باسمه ليوم 11 مارس، وهذا يختلف تماماً عن مصر. يوم 25 دعت فيه أعتقد أكثر من 25 جمعية أو شيء، بعضها معترف فيها بعضها غير، نزلت أسماءها في الدعوة. في أماكن أخرى في تونس الاتحاد الشغل تبنى المظاهرات، فعلى الأقل في هناك جهة عندها شرعية تدعو لهذا الشيء. إحنا ما أحد عنده، ما أحد طلع قال مين أنت. إحنا نعرف أن اللي دعا الجهات أخرى، بس هذه الجهات يعني واقعياً وحقيقياً في المجتمع ليس عندها أثر حقيقي في المجتمع السعودي. فبالتالي إذا حصل إصلاحات سياسية مثل انتخابات مجلس شورى منتخب مثل أشياء أخرى، أنا أعتقد أنه جزء كبير جداً من المجتمع رايح يكون يعني متفق مع هذه ورايح يقدرها.
أتوجه بالشكر الجزيل لمنظمي هذا المؤتمر وللذين راعوا أهله وقدموا كل جهد وبذلوا ما ساعد على إنجاحه. لكن لي ملاحظة كنت أود يعني أن تأخذ بالاعتبار، لا يجوز في بيروت عاصمة الثقافة ومركز الانطلاق الفكري القومي العربي أن نتحدث عن الثورة العربية بلغة أجنبية. لي مداخلة وليس سؤال. الفيسبوك موجود في كل مكان ولكنه لم يفعل ما فعله في مصر وتونس وفي اليمن، لأننا لم يعني نورد الحقيقة المعاناة العميقة لجماهير شعبنا. إن الذين قاموا بهذه الثورة هم طليعة من شباب عاجزوا عن تحقيق طموحاتهم البسيطة وواجهوا الطغيان والفساد والرشوة وزواج تزاوج رأس المال السياسي مع السلطة، وبذلك فقدوا كثير من الأمل ولم يجدوا وسيلة إلا الثورة على هذا المجتمع الفاسد. ثور رجل في 86 مريض ويريد للمرة العاشرة أن يجدد لنفسه، وإن لم يكن له فلابنه. هؤلاء اثنين جمال وعلاء حصلوا على الثروة الفاحشة نتيجة قيام مصر ببيع الغاز لإسرائيل بأسعار تحت الكلفة. المطلوب في كل مكان هو تغيير النظام السياسي وليس الإصلاح، ويتحايل البعض على الإصلاح بتدابير وفتات اقتصادية. فدي دولة خليجية راتب شهرين و20% و50 زيادات للمدنيين والعسكريين على السواء، رغم أن كل هذا لا يشكل 1% من دخل يوزع على أصحاب النفط لأنهم هم أصحاب النفط. أبو عزيز يعني شوزن وضعه شاب يحمل شهادة جامعية عجز خلال سنين عن إيجاد وظيفة، فباع الخضرة على عربائه صدرها شرط البلدية، قطع رزقه نهائي. فقطع رزقه وهو أجا قطع رزق النظام. ما لا أريد أن أطيل، أقول نتمنى أن نركز على الحالة النفسية والوضع الاجتماعي لهؤلاء الشباب الذين عانوا من الاستبداد والقهر والظلم والفساد فثاروا على كل هذا. وشكرا.
شكرا. اترك لمحمد في نقاط مهمة طبعا للتعليق عليها.
يعني هو بشكرك على التعليق، و يعني هو تعليق حضرتك يمكن مكمل للسؤال السابق، فإذا أذنت لي بتعليق صغير. حقيقة يعني حضرتك بدأت قائلا ان الفيسبوك موجود في كل مكان بس ما حصلش حاجة. يمكن عشان إذا درسنا حاجة يمكن بعد كده ندرس اللي حصل، ندرس ثورات، ندرس تحركات سياسية، هو بيبقى فيه أسباب عميقة وأسباب لحظية في يعني في فهم المتواضع. أسباب عميقة زي ما حضرتك قلت ان الفساد، النهب، الثروات و و، والأسباب اللحظية منها كان احنا بالنسبة لنا في مصر كان من ضمنها خالد سعيد، هو شاب قتل على 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 يد الشرطة المصرية من شهور. كان من ضمنها كمان الثورة التونسية، كان من أسباب اللحظية اللي شجعتنا احنا. وفي هذا السياق يعني احب احيي الناس اللي قاموا بالثورة التونسية واشكرهم، لان لولا الهامهم ما كناش احنا نزلنا الشارع. بس فالفيسبوك وغيره بقى من الحاجات اللي هي نموها ساعد على قيام الحاجات دي. وبالتالي اذا احنا سالنا نفسنا طيب ثورات ولا اصلاح، ثوره ولا اصلاح، اذا كنا فعلا عايزين ثوره يبقى احنا لازم نشوف ايه اللي احنا محتاجينه عشان الثوره تقوم ونسعى ان احنا ننمي. بس اختم بس بالنقطه دي. شكرا ليك.
مور كويستشنز سايد هذا.
بسام شحادات من درعا من سوريا. اولا شكرا لإتاحة الفرصة للسؤال. انا بس بدي اسال سؤال، انه بالفترة الماضية لما شفنا الثورات بمصر وتونس كان واحد من العوامل الاساسية لما ينقطع الانترنت عن اي دولة فيها ثورة الشعب بالدول الثانية يساعد ويعمل تريند على تويتر ويضل يحدث الاخبار. لأي درجة بتوقع ممكن بيوم من الأيام نشهد إنه دولة عربية تمنع مواطنين من دعم ثورة بدولة تانية، أو لأنه ممكن يكون انتقلت العدوى؟ يعني ممكن هلأ نحن ممكن نشهد إنه أحد المدونين بالسعودية يعتقل لأنه هو دعم ثورة بلبنان مثلا. هل الشبكات الاجتماعية ساعدتنا إنه نحن ندعم بعض أكثر مع وجود الفوارق الموجودة بين الدول؟ شكرا.
نادين أو فؤاد؟
أنا ما بعرف إذا صايرة قبل هيدا الشيء، بس بتصور إنه انسى الدول، يعني الشعب عم بيدعم شعب، ما في دولة عم توقف مع دولة عربية بالطريقة اللي المفروض يكون عم توقف فيها، بس الشعب يلي موجود على تويتر وعلى فيسبوك يعني عم نشوف حالات من الوحدة بين كل بلادنا عم بتصير كتير جيدة، بس ما بعرف إذا صار في حالات.
يعني أنا أعتقد يعني في عالم ما قبل أبو عزيزي هو يختلف عن عالم ما بعد أبو عزيزي. هذه زمنين مختلفة. أعتقد أن الأنظمة السياسية بشكل عام إذا تجاوزت مسألة هل أنا نيكست ولا لا، أوكي، فالمسألة اللي بعدها طيب كيف ما أتحرش زيادة بالشعب، أوكي. يعني هي إذا ما رايح تغير إصلاحات فالمفروض، يعني إذا تفكر بتفكيرهم، ما رايح يحاول يسبب أسباب جديدة لكثير من القلاقل. فأنا أعتقد أن السقف ارتفع كبير جداً. العالم العربي ثبت توحده كشعوب في كل اللي صار، وثبت هذا من خلال الإعلام الاجتماعي، الدعم الرهيب لبعض الشباب في دول عربية لا يحصل فيها مثلاً ثورات ولا يحصل فيها عدم استقرار، تجد كأنه يتكلم عن الثورة الفلانية كأنه من أهلها وكأنه من الشعب وكأنه مبارك هو الحاكم. هو في الحقيقة يفرغ شيء من الداخل اللي موجود عنده بشكل لا إرادي في طرف آخر. لكن حتى لو جيت قلت له طيب أنا بتكلم عن إيش صاير عندكم، يقول لك يا أخي لا إحنا لسه يعني لا خصوصية ولا تتكلم كذا. فالحقيقة إنه الشعوب ما تحتاج أي توصيات ولا شيء. الشيء اللي صار غير مسبوق في ناحية الدعم على مستوى العالم العربي من خلال الشبكات الاجتماعية الموجودة ومن خلال كل الوسائل الأخرى.
خاصة على سوريا طلال الملوحي مش مدونة سورية عندها 19 سنة تسجنت وكتب عشان كتبت تدوينات عن حبا في فلسطين على ما أذكر. أدي مثال لمدونة عربية سندت كفاح شعب عربي آخر وعوقبت بسببه. وده مأساة وده إحنا كلنا مش بنعمل كفاية عشان نفرج عن سجناء رأي العرب على فكرة من ضمنهم المدونين. لازم نتحرك أكتر من كده. بالنسبة لموضوع لما قطع الإنترنت بس ملحوظة صغيرة، إحنا يوم ما قطع الإنترنت في مصر عرفنا قبلها بساعات قليلة إن هيقطعوا الإنترنت ويقطعوا الموبايلات. الساعة 1-2 الصبح كلمنا أصحابنا، حد كلمني قال لي كلم الناس أصحابك اللي برا مصر قول لهم. وفعلا كلمت ناس، متهيألي حتى عمر كريستيديس أنا كلمته الساعة 2 الصبح صحيته من النوم. ريم خوري كلمتها صحيتها من النوم في عمان، عمر هنا في بيروت. فكانت الرسالة اللي احنا كنا عايزين نطلعها برا مصر هو الإنترنت هيقطع، المعلومات اللي احنا نقدر نطلعها هتقل، عليكم انتوا واجب المعلومات. وبالفعل في ناس كتير قوي من ضمنهم اميره كانت المفروض تكون موجوده، من ضمنهم القاسمي اعتقد في دبي عمل شغل هايل برضه في السفاره المصريه، واحنا كنا في ايام اللي كنا شغالين فيها. فلا النتورك السوشيال ميديا يوزرز في الوطن العربي قوي جدا، اكثر من رائع وحمانه وساعدنا كتير.
اوكي راح اخذ اخر سؤالين بعدين ويل كونكلود.
سليم عقيل من سوريا. نحن عندنا مشكلة بسوريا أن أغلب الشباب السوري خايف يعبر عن رأيه بشكل صريح عن طريق الفيسبوك، فعاوز رسالة من شخص منكم باعتبار خاض التجربة أنه يبعث رسالة للشباب السوري بحيث ممكن يفكر فيها ويتخطى حاجز الخوف تبعه بحيث يعبر عن رأيه صريح عن طريق الفيسبوك.
يعني أنا ما أنا خبير جدا في، يعني للأسف ما قد شرفت بزيارة سوريا فما أقدر أحكم كيف الوضع، لكن يس بالضبط.
إذا بناخذ السؤال مش لسوريا سبيسيفيك بس بشكل عام، الشباب العربي عنده الخوف، حاجز الخوف، فشو نصيحتكم يعني كبانل للشباب العربي ليتخطى حاجز الخوف لأنه هو اللي بده يغير بالآخر مستقبلنا بشبابنا، إذا ما تكلموا شبابنا وما تحدثوا ما راح يكون في تغيير.
صحيح. يعني أنا أعتقد أو عندي قناعة تامة دائما أقولها للأصدقاء وللإخوان في حالة الحديث عن شيء، أول حاجة التعليق إذا كان في تعبير، حرية التعبير عن رأي معين حول قضية معينة، يجب بكل صدق أن تكون القضية صحيحة وتكون صادقة ويكون الحدث حقيقي. لما تكون القضية حقيقية والحدث حقيقي أنت ما تترك مجال كبير للطرف الآخر أنه يضايقك فيقول لك أنت كذبت، أنت افتريت، أنت قلت شيء ما هو معقول. إذا كان الحدث حقيقي وتعليقك مارستك حرية التعبير حول الحدث حقيقي ستجد معك ناس كثير. الحاجة الثانية لا تتجاوز بشكل منفرد السقف الموجود بشكل عام منفردا. يعني إذا كان السقف محدد بشكل محدد فهناك مجموعة تجدهم من المدونين من المهتمين بالشأن العام يقود السقف هذا سويا. الانفراد في مسألة حقيقة أنت تغرد خارج السرب وتروح المناطق خطيرة أكثر من المطلوب، ولا تجد لا تترك مساحة كبيرة للناس كثير يدافعوا عنك لأنه يشوفونك أنت تجاوزت شيء هم أصلا ما يؤمنوا
بس
فيه.
أنت يعني آسف للتعليق بس كفؤاد الفرحان أنت غردت خارج السرب ولا لا؟
لا أنا كان معايا يعني السعودية فيها حركة تدوين، فيها مجموعة تدوينية متميزة، يمكن أنا اللي طاح علي السقف بس يعني لكن لكن في النهاية أنت عندك شيء. الحاجة الأخرى أنه فعلا يكون الانطلاق حقيقي، يعني أنا ما أعرف كيف تقاس هذه، لكن أن يكون الهم وطني، أن يكون الهم تقدر تجمع عليه أكبر عدد من الناس، ليس هم طائفي، ليس هم فئوي، هو هم وطني في النهاية. فصدقني في الحالات الصعبة تجد دعم من أماكن ومن جهات ومن أشخاص غير معقول ما دام الخط
والطريق اللي انت ماشي فيه حقيقة هو منطقي بشكل كبير لناس كبيرة.
My name is Rani Dababne. I'm also called Jordanaholic. My question is, here I am. well, coming from the revolutions in Tunisia and Egypt and currently in Libya, I see people like going in two ways. Like some people are rational and some people are emotional. Some people, they have alternative plan for the current system. Some people don't. So my question is like, do you think that people in Egypt, for example, or Tunisia, when they were in the middle of the protest, did they have alternative plan? Like when you ask them, they are all agree on the, on one fact that we are all against Mubarak, but who are you with? Would they answer that? On the other hand, what do you support? Do you support a revolution with a ready plan, or you just want to protest? Then, بعدين بفرش ربنا.
Right. Well, I mean, there are several parts to this answer, but the first day of the revolution was January 25th. يلي هو عيد الشرطة بمصر. So actually, the revolution started on Police Day, which commemorates a day when, you know, back in the day when the police was on our side. It was an event when the police had a big fight with the Brits, and many officers were killed, and that's what January 25th commemorates essentially. And the revolutions, pardon me, yes, the protest on the 25th started as being a protest against police brutality. That's what it started on. Several hours down the line. On the square, it had morphed to the people demand the fall of the regime, Shabi Reed's Qatar Nizam. So it started as something, and that with time, and also with the violence of the government. I mean, a lot of the reason why that revolution, I believe, succeeded was partly because of the government's stupid behavior all the way throughout these 18 days. Their reactions made people more entrenched in their position, and essentially had people raise their demands. So that's part of it. We support revolution, we support the fall of Mubarak, do we support something else? It didn't start as that. And I mean, I'm also a journalist, so we'd ask people on the square, you know, it's like, okay, so you don't want Mubarak, Gamil, who else? Like, who do you want instead? And the answer you generally get was, let's get rid of that regime, we'll figure it out later. Now that's a negative, partly because right now we're trying to answer that question. Now, okay, so Mubarak's gone, what do we do? But in the same time, and that was very important in terms of political communication, at least, if you think of it, if you can unite people around a very simple demand, like everybody agreed on, we don't want Mubarak. Right? So that was clear, and that got people very mobilized. If we had gotten into, we don't want Mubarak, but we want person X, Y, or Z instead, then you would have lost a lot of the momentum of the revolution. So it was a good thing, actually, that we were focused on a very clear, you know, 1, 2, 3 small demands, the end of Amn al-Dawla, of the state security, of the emergency law, and the fall of the regime. So that actually helped us not slow down the revolution.
Thank you.
Shukran. محمد، النقاش طبعا شيق ولا ينتهي، ولكن وقتنا قد انتهى، وكلنا متشوقون لسماع فادي غندور، وهو ثورجي. الثورات مش بس في السياسة وعلى الحكومات، ولكن في ريادة الأعمال وفي تغيير المجتمعات. فبشكر البانل محمد، فؤاد، ونادين، وشكرا للجميع.